Hello, this is the first video about Russia and the USSR between 1855 and 1964. Stuff you need to know to do your coursework. Okay, first video is about Tsar Alexander II. He became Tsar in 1855 when his father died. His father, Nicholas I, died in 1855 in the middle of the Crimean War that they were fighting against Britain. And Tsar Alexander II lived until he himself was assassinated by a terrorist group called the People's Will in 1881. The thing that Tsar Alexander II is most famous for is the emancipation of the serfs in 1861. Emancipation means giving people their freedom, and the serfs were the peasants who didn't have their freedom. They were owned either by landlords, the nobility, the upper classes, the big landowners in the countryside who owned the big the big manor house in villages and owned all the land, and they also owned the peasantry. They literally could buy and sell the peasants. The peasants couldn't do whatever they liked. They didn't like living the place they were born and lived in. They couldn't move to another village. They were owned. They were the property of the landlords. Well, Tsar Alexander II thought that this needed to be abolished, especially after the problems that Russia had in the Crimean War, had exposed kind of the backwardness and the weaknesses of Russia. And he thought that giving the peasantry their freedom, and he announced it in 1856, it actually came into being with the Emancipation Decree of 1861, that's the law of 1861. He thought giving them their freedom would free them up, it would make them more dynamic, it would make them more enterprising, perhaps a bit more entrepreneurial, would modernize them, and in turn he hoped that that would help strengthen the country. He also thought that it might make them a bit more loyal to the Tsar as well. He famously said, either we abolish emancipation from above, or the serfs will emancipate themselves from below. What he feared was that the serfs would rise up and overthrow the landowning classes, and perhaps even, as they were the vast mass of the Russian population, something like 90%, 88-90% of the population, he feared that they would overthrow the whole system and Russia would be thrown into chaos. And so giving them their freedom was a way of kind of buying their loyalty, I suppose. That's the thing he's most famous for. Whether it worked or not, whether it had the effect that he wanted, is a kind of another story, a long story. Basically, whilst the peasants were given their kind of theoretical freedom, so they were no longer owned, they could marry who they wanted, they could move where they wanted, in reality, it didn't really affect their lives positively that much. In reality, most peasants ended up, after emancipation, farming less land than they'd owned when they'd farmed when they were owned by the landlords. The reason being, and this was the big problem with emancipation, was that instead of farming the landlord's land, what the scheme was that they were supposed to buy land from the landowners. And in order to, where did they get the money to buy the land from? They had to take out huge loans from the government and pay those loans back over the period of like 49 years at very high interest rates. It was basically like getting a huge mortgage. And it also enabled the government to compensate the landlords who had lost their land and lost their free slave labor. But the trouble was, it landed the peasants in a huge amount of debt that it was going to take them 50 years to pay off. The landlords themselves often kept the best land for themselves, and the peasants in most cases ended up with less land than they had before. And many peasants, way over a million peasants, ended up with no land at all, so ended up having to become employees for the landlords. So emancipation didn't really have the desired effect. And there were rebellions against Alexander II, and they wanted a second, the peasants wanted a second emancipation, but he made it quite clear that there was not going to be a second emancipation, that they should, you know, need to content themselves with what they had, that enough, that, you know, emancipation had been enough of a change, and that was that. So it ended, it didn't really address any of the problems that it was supposed to do, but the Tsar was known as the Tsar Liberator because he gave so many people their freedom. So it was still a kind of great reform. It just wasn't perhaps as successful as it might have been. Other than the emancipation, the other thing that Alexander II is most known for is his political reforms. He allowed for the election in rural villages of things called the zemstvo or zemstva for plural in 1864, and these were elected rural councils in the countryside, and these are significant because this meant for the first time that decisions about local affairs like local policing or local law and order, local education, could be made by elected officials, and peasants could be elected onto these elected bodies, the zemstva. This is significant because Alexander II, above all else, was an autocrat. He was an emperor. He ruled with absolute power. He had supreme power. No law got made in Russia unless he gave his approval to it. But arguably, by introducing the zemstva in 1864, in the countryside and in the towns and cities, Duma, that's the Russian word for kind of parliament, but these were only in towns and cities, not on a national scale. That's an important distinction to make. Arguably, this was a really, really significant, important reform because it was the first time that autocracy was perhaps giving way a little bit to a little bit of democracy, signs of democracy in Russia. In fact, Alexander II was considering plans put to him by one of his ministers for a national parliament when he was assassinated in 1881. And if he'd gone through with that, that would have been a really, really significant reform in Russian history. And who knows, perhaps might have satisfied enough people and sort of quietened down the kind of the people in the country who were anti the Tsar and anti the system and wanted to replace it and overthrow it. Perhaps it might have pacified those people, and perhaps, who knows, some pressure might not have built up so much that led eventually to the fairly that led to the overthrow of the whole system during the First World War. However, the reforms didn't go ahead in 1881 because he was assassinated by a terrorist group called the People's Will, who thought that the only way that Russia was going to change was through a violent revolution. You had to get rid of the Tsar, you had to get rid of the whole system and rebuild Russia anew. So they assassinated him. Didn't really have the desired effect because it just meant his son became the next Tsar, Alexander III, and he was determined not to weaken autocracy in any way. And I'll tell you about that in the next video.